देवे प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंदा श्री अद्वैता गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंदा। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे
कृष्ण
हरे,
हरे
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 रामा
हरे
हरे
राम
रामा
हरे
राम
राम
रामा
राम
हरे
राम
हरे।
हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। हरे कृष्णा प्रभु
सो
जी।
टुडे इज अ स्पेशल डे एज वी ऑल नो। वी जस्ट हैविंग कीर्तन फॉर दैट। सो वी डिसाइडेड दैट टुडे इंस्टेड ऑफ हैविंग अवर रेगुलर भगवद गीता क्लास वी कैन यू नो स्पीक अबाउट और हियर अबाउट लॉर्ड बलराम अ लिटिल बिट टुडे। सो कृष्णा एक्चुअली सेज इन द भगवद गीता इटसेल्फ इन 15.7 ही सेज ममैवांशो जीवलोके जीवभूता सनातन। ही सेज can everyone else be on mute, please? I hear some echo. I can hear myself. So, yeah, thank you. So he says, "Mamaivamsho jivaloke jivabhuta sanatana." So he says, actually, all the living entities in this universe, they are my parts and parcels. So that is the first part of this sentence. So actually, Acharya explained that you know, as part of Krishna, we are supposed to have attraction for Krishna, and because we have given up our attraction for Krishna, so what Krishna, the same verse 15.7, he says, "Manaha shasthani indriyani prakriti sthani karshati." No, we have come under the control of the six senses, you know, which includes the mind, and because of that, we have got situated in the material universe, in the prakriti. And we are struggling very hard with our senses. So karshati, karshati means there is friction. So we are supposed to have attraction, or we are supposed to have akarshan for Krishna, but because we have given up our akarshan, we are having karshan in this universe. You know, it's like struggling very hard in this universe. So Lord Balaram actually plays a very important role. You know, his role is that, you know, he helps us to rekindle our lost love, our lost attraction for Krishna. And at the same time, Lord Balaram is also very merciful. He's more merciful than Krishna. And I actually found out today itself, like I personally experienced it in one way, because I only had to fast until noon. You know, otherwise, if it is Krishna's appearance, it is going to have to fast for the whole day until midnight. So that way, we know that Lord Balaram is even more, you know, merciful than Krishna. So that's why we'll discuss a little bit today about Lord Balaram. Now, one other important thing is when we speak about our guru, so we know that Lord Balaram is the Adi Guru, and he is like, so all the gurus that we have, they represent Lord Balaram. So actually, the scriptures explain that, you know, we are supposed to be Vishnu Parayana. Vishnu Parayana means we are supposed to be devotees of Lord Vishnu. That is our natural position, Vishnu or Krishna, you know. But what has happened is Krishna describes in the 16th chapter that instead of Vishnu Parayana, we have become Kama Krodha Parayana. He says, no, we have become devotees of lust and anger. I don't know about everyone else, but it applies to me definitely. So actually, no, we have to again become, you know, from the devotees of lust and anger, from Kama Krodha Parayana, we have to go and become Vishnu Parayana again. So it's like a journey. You have to travel from, you know, Kama Krodha Parayana to Vishnu Parayana. So that journey actually happens through Shruti Parayana. So actually, in the 13th chapter, if you remember, Krishna had said that, you know, that there are people who, just by hearing about Krishna, they perfect themselves. So hearing is a very important limb of devotional service, and you know, it actually purifies us. So, and especially when we hear about the different pastimes of the Lord, that is definitely very, you know, purifying. So we are talking about Balaram Jayanti. Balaram Jayanti is the occasion where Balaramji appeared thousands of years ago. And he appeared, you know, we all know it's like his appearance is like a precursor to Krishna's appearance. So he appeared just before Krishna. So now we have Balaram Jayanti today. And I believe 11th August is when we have Lord Krishna's appearance day. So all over the world, there are people who believe in God and, you know, they direct their belief and devotion in God in accordance of whatever conception of God they have acquired from their, you know, from their culture or their tradition. So we all know, we have heard about Bhaktivinod Thakur. He has written many multiple books. So he explains that the same one absolute truth reveals himself in different ways at different places. There can be some differences in the message of the Lord depending on the context, depending on the culture, depending on the audience. But essentially, there is one absolute truth. And that absolute truth has revealed himself in various ways at different places. But how much we can become attracted to the absolute truth, how much we can become devoted to the absolute truth, a major factor in determining that is how much we know about that person. Now, sometimes we say that knowledge is the only thing to know, you know, to rekindle our devotion to Krishna. But actually, knowledge about God alone doesn't bring devotion towards God. You know, we have heard, we discussed also in our regular Bhagavad Gita sessions that there are academic scholars. So there are some scholars, we were discussing the example of that how there was this discussion happening between His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj and one of the PhD scholars who has done PhD on Gita Govinda. So he was like kind of denigrating Krishna in one sense. So there are academic scholars who have done, you know, PhD on Krishna, and they don't even believe that Krishna existed, or they may believe that Krishna existed as a person, but he was not God. So knowledge alone doesn't engender devotion, but knowledge is helpful in practicing the process that engenders devotion. So knowledge is not the way, but knowledge, you know, it inspires us to go along the way. And as far as knowledge is concerned, there is enormous knowledge about God that is given in the Bhakti tradition of ancient India. So we all have experienced it. We have read it. We have been, you know, actually accepting this knowledge in our tradition, the tradition that is the parampara, as we say. So we are, you know, all accepting that knowledge, and we have experienced it firsthand. So we can't say that we don't have knowledge in our tradition. So Srila Prabhupada, you know, he would often say that if you want to have a concrete conception about God, here there is concrete conception about God. Now it is Krishna. Now we have all the details about him, like what he looks like, what he does, who he is with, and what are his likes, you know. So all this knowledge is there. We have very clear, concrete knowledge. So Srila Prabhupada was once in America, here in America. At that time, some Christian priest came to him. I think it is also described in SSR, in Science of Self-Realization. So Prabhupada said to him, there is one God who is revealed in various traditions. So the Christian priest argued that if Krishna is the same one God whom Jesus talked about, then why did Jesus not specifically talk about Krishna? So Srila Prabhupada said that Jesus himself said that I have so much more to tell you, but you don't have the ears to hear. At some points, Prabhupada would be very, you know, hard also. No, once he said that, you know, Jesus just repeated that thou shall not kill. And he himself was killed for that. So, you know, how much more could he have said in such circumstances? So, am I audible to everyone?
Yes, to me it is.
Okay, good. So just testing because I was getting some message here. Okay. So the point here is not to denigrate any religion. The important point to highlight is that the principle. The principle is, if you are interested in knowing God, then wherever knowledge about God is available, so take that knowledge and benefit yourselves. So Srila Rupa Goswami in the Nectar of Devotion, he quotes a principle from Padma Purana. He says, "Yena kena prakaren mana Krishna divesheyat." No, see, somehow or the other, I have to make my mind attached to Krishna. So now, if we have to understand this from an example, you know, suppose a student studies in some engineering college here in like some college affiliated to, say, UConn. And after that, you know, he wants to do a master's in computer science. And he comes to know that, you know, MIT is the best college in America to do masters in computer science. Now, he won't say that, no, I will do masters only in my college. You know, I'll not go to MIT. I'll just do it in my college. Now, if a student starts saying like that, then naturally the question would come, no, are you interested in knowledge or are you interested in college? You know, there's a natural question that will come up. So similarly, we can ask, you know, are we interested in religion or are we interested in God? You know, religion is meant for God. God is not meant for religion. So wherever deeper knowledge about God is available, we can take that knowledge and we enrich ourselves. So in bhakti tradition, not only is there knowledge about God, but there is, you know, also knowledge about God's family. So what it means is, you know, God is not alone. God is definitely supreme, but that doesn't mean, you know, that he has to live somewhere in isolation. So he lives with his whole family. And one of his closest associates is his brother. Now, God also has a consort, as we all know, but we'll discuss about that later when we come closer to Janmashtami and Radhashtami. So currently, we'll focus on this principle that God has a full family. And actually, not just one, he has two full families. We'll talk about it, and many of you already know. So actually in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna describes that this word is actually like a reflection of the spiritual world. It says, Urdhva Moolam Adha Shakham Ashvattham Prahur Avyayam Chandamsi Yasya Parnani Yastam Veda Savedavit. Now in 15.1, this 15.1, we have been discussing the 15th chapter, I believe last we did 15.11. So in 15.1, Krishna says that this word is like an upside down banyan tree. We see an upside down banyan tree. This is what Prabhupada explains in the purport, that we see an upside down banyan tree where there is a reflection of a tree in water. Excuse me. So there is a real tree somewhere, and what we experience in this world is a reflection of that real tree. So whatever relationships we see in this world, those relationships are there in God, and they are there in the full purity and perfection. So Krishna and Balaram, they are two divine brothers. And when they would go around fighting, we have read the different pastimes, each of them would be unmatched. But when the two of them would come together, they were like the awesome twosome. Nobody could match them. So we know the pastimes where Jarasandh attacks Mathura, when Krishna and Balaram were both in Mathura, and not just once, he actually attacked 17 times, and each time Krishna and Balaram would, just Krishna and Balaram, there no other soldiers would come to fight, and they would annihilate the whole army of Jarasandh, and Jarasandh would go back again, and then he'll again bring a big army, and then again Krishna and Balaram would annihilate the army. So this happened 17 times, and after that we know that Krishna moved with the Mathura Vasis to Dwarka. So from there, Dwarka Leela starts from there. But now coming back to what we were discussing. So Balaram, his name signifies his position. The word Balaram means, it has two aspects, Bala and Rama. So Bal means strength and Ram means pleasure. So Balaram refers to that person who gives us the strength to find pleasure. He is the person in this who gives us a strength in this world to find pleasure. Now, what does this mean that, he gives us the strength to find pleasure? Say if I have some nice meals available here right in front of me, so I can just pick up and eat it. I don't need any strength from anyone to pick up and eat that, So, but what it means is pleasure is not found in this world where it appears to be. This word promises us so much pleasure, but all those pleasures are like temporary. They are mriga trishni rupa. They are like mirages. This is what Prahlad Maharaj says in the sixth canto, I believe, of Srimad Bhagavatam, if I am not wrong. So they promise a lot of pleasure, but they deliver very little. And yet it is very difficult to resist the lure of the pleasure. So there are people who are alcoholics and they don't want to be alcoholics. So what they do is there are some medicines or drugs which are available. And what happens is, if after taking that drug, if someone drinks alcohol, so that will make the person very sick. This drug reacts with alcohol. So they actually take the drug thinking that this will force us to not consume alcohol. But in spite of taking that, you know, they are compulsively dragged to consume alcohol and then they fall sick. But each time they will do this. So what is happening here is they don't have the strength to resist the lure of the pleasure. So the strength to find pleasure and then, you know, the strength to find the real pleasure and then move from the illusory pleasure to the real pleasure, that requires strength. And that strength is provided by Balaramji. So his role is to give us the strength to resist the pleasures of this world and the strength to persevere in seeking the pleasure of bhakti. Now in bhakti, there is pleasure, but we need to persevere. We don't get it immediately. We all have experienced it. It's not that, you know, as soon as today, if we start practicing bhakti, we'll start getting pleasure right from day one. That's not how it works. Krishna says, you know, in the 18th chapter, there's a verse where Krishna says, Yattat agre visham eva pariname amrotopam. Now he says, in 18.36, that higher pleasures, they taste like poison in the beginning, but they taste like nectar in the end. So we have to persevere through the poison till we can get to the nectar. And that requires strength. So Balaram is that divine person who gives us the strength to find that pleasure in this world. He gives us the strength to find that pleasure. And in this role, he acts as the Adi Guru. So we have all heard that term Adi Guru multiple times. So he is the original spiritual master. The spiritual master's primary role is, what is the primary role of spiritual master? Can anyone mention it?
To guide the souls back to Godhead.
Yeah. So in one way, we can say that the spiritual master's primary role is to help us find real happiness in life. You know, Srila Prabhupada was once giving a lecture on Rath Yatra day here in America, actually. I think it was the second Rath Yatra, if I'm not wrong, in 1969. It's a very famous lecture. Initial days, we all know that the most of the followers who came to Srila Prabhupada, they were all hippies. So Prabhupada in the lecture, he says that you hippies, you are not very much appreciated in America. Now you are called as frustrated people, but Prabhupada said, I appreciate you. Now, he said, human life is meant to be frustrated. It's a very interesting thing. He says, why is it? No, he says, when we become frustrated in our search for happiness, then we will search for higher pleasures. And then he says, we'll come to Athato Brahma Jigyasa. Then we will inquire about spiritual truths. No other acharya has explained Athato Brahma Jigyasa to mean that human life is meant to be frustrated. Now, this was Prabhupada's contemporary presentation of Shastra. So spiritual master is meant to guide us. When we become thwarted in our search for happiness, to guide us where the real pleasure exists. And Balaramji actually plays that role. I'm keeping my eye on the watch because I've been told to finish on time. So I also want to leave some time for us to be able to, you know, for everyone to share their reflections, etc.
Sure.
I know, I remember Prabhuji. So... So we have many spiritual masters in our lives. We have one Diksha Guru, we can say, but we have many Shiksha Gurus. And all of them are manifesting the mercy of Balaram. It is by his mercy that the spiritual masters we have in our lives, they guide us. We have the famous verse in Bhagavad Gita, I believe it's 4.34, if I'm not wrong. It says, Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinaha. Now the significant point over here is, the Bhagavad Gita is using plural, tattva darshi naha, not one tattva darshi, but darshi naha, it is plural. So there are many spiritual masters and we learn from many spiritual teachers. And they all are giving us knowledge by the grace of Balaramji. So now, in this world, Balaramji plays the role of being the guru, but in Krishna Leela, he plays another role. In Krishna Leela comprise mostly, if we look at the Krishna Leela, it comprises of devotees who are already elevated. You know, they are already liberated and they are already purified. So there he doesn't have to play this role. So he plays the role of assistant of Krishna and you know, he assists Krishna in various ways. So we know that he becomes the bed, the Shesha bed on which Vishnu lies, and then he also expands himself to become the Dham itself. So similarly, there are many different ways in which he assists Krishna. He actually comes and assists him in all his pastimes. Whenever Krishna descends to this world, we know he descended as Nityananda with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He descended as Lakshman with Lord Ram. So there are many ways in which he serves Krishna. Excuse me. But we'll focus on one way in which he assists Krishna. This is actually described in the book Gopal Champu. We know that it's written by Srila Jiva Goswami. So Jiva Goswami, as we all know, he is known as the Siddhanta Acharya of Gaudiya Vaishnavism. So he establishes the Siddhanta. So now Gopal Champu, what some of us would have heard about, it is like an expanded retelling of the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. It's not like a verse by verse commentary. So, but what he does is he takes the basic storyline of the 10th canto and then he expands on it. And this expansion is based on different shastras. He quotes different shastras, actually, many different. Sometimes when I read that, I've not even heard the names of those shastras, some tantra, and you know, so it's very nice. And he also actually, based on his own revelations also, he basically expands the storyline that we find in Srimad Bhagavatam. The Bhagavatam storyline is very, very concise. So there he describes, now Balaramji helps Krishna remember Vrindavan outside of Vrindavan. So if you actually, if you see the life of Krishna and Balaram, and especially Krishna, their lives are very adventurous. Right from the time, and even before the time he was born, there was a whole conspiracy to murder the child. And this child is like whisked away at night and he goes to like a distant place and stays. While he's staying there, you know, there are various assassins who are sent to assassinate him and he survives somehow. Eventually, what happens is, we know the storyline, eventually Krishna and Balaram are told to come to Mathura. Kamsa decides that actually, you know, my men are not able to get him in Vrindavan. So I will let him come to my territory, and in my territory, my men will get him. That is actually his overall plan. So what happens is that, you know, we know that Akrura comes to take Krishna. And so the Nand Maharaj, you know, he doesn't know that Krishna is not his son. Nand Maharaj actually thinks that Krishna is my son only. He has not even a slightest conception that Krishna is not my son. So there is this pastime also when Krishna is just born and he has just come to Vrindavan as a baby. At that time, Garg Muni comes, you know, for the name giving ceremony. So at that time, questions may be raised that Garg Muni is like the family priest of the Yadus, and why is he doing the ceremony of Nanda Maharaj's side? So actually, Garg Muni is a Brahman and he doesn't want to speak lies, but at the same time, he doesn't want to speak the truth also. So there are multiple reasons for this. One is that he doesn't want to raise the suspicion of Kamsa, and also because Nanda Maharaj has such intense love for Krishna that Garg Muni doesn't have the heart to tell him that, you know, Krishna is not your son. So what he does is, he says that in a previous life, your son was the son of Vasudeva. And he also says that your son is almost like Narayan. He doesn't say that he is actually Narayan or the source of Narayan. He says he is almost like Narayan. So when Akrura comes and tells Krishna that you are actually the son of Vasudev and you should come back and help Vasudev, so Nanda Maharaj doesn't accept it. He doesn't accept that Krishna is not his son. But still, because it is an order from Kamsa and Kamsa is the king there, they all decide to go to Mathura. So all of them, many of the Gopas also accompany Krishna and Balaram both go. Nanda Maharaj also come with them and they all go to Mathura. So generally, all of us have the conception that Krishna is God and he went and effortlessly killed Kamsa. But if we consider it from the Leela perspective, Krishna is just a small child, barely 10 years old. No, I don't think he is even 10 years old at that time when he leaves Vrindavan and goes to Mathura. So at the age of 10, he has to leave all those who throughout his life, you know, he thought as his parents. And, you know, he has to go to somebody else and accept them as parents. So it is like, say, some parents have given up their child at the time of birth. And when the child grows up and he has become like a teen, suddenly the parents would come back and then they claim the custody rights. So this is like more like a contemporary example. So, but what happens is it is very, very disruptive for the child. So for Krishna, it is like that. No, he has these intriguing two aspects. He exhibits superhuman strength when he kills demons like Aghasura, Kamsa. But then after Kamsa is killed, then there are these Yadu elders. Now they tell that Krishna, you should stay with us. No, you are a Yadu and there are other enemies also who are Kamsa's allies. And what will happen is now that Kamsa has been killed by you, they will become enraged and they will attack us from different directions. So we need protection and we won't be able to sustain ourselves. We won't be able to sustain their attack. So you should stay here with us and you should protect us. So now Krishna somehow persuades Nanda Maharaj. It's like a very, very sweet and moving conversation that Krishna and Nanda Maharaj have. So Krishna says that, you know, based on the prophecy that the eighth child of Devaki will kill Kamsa, so based on that prophecy, they are claiming that I am their son. So Nanda Maharaj starts crying and then he says, no, anyway, it is our fortune that great people are claiming our son to be their son. So he says that, no, if you are going to stay here, Krishna, then I will also come and stay here. And we will stay outside Mathura and we will have our own house here. And Mother Yashoda will also come. And, at least we will be able to see you every day. Even if you are not staying in the same house, at least we'll be able to see you every day. And then Krishna says that, we are all the servants of the cows. And now we have so many cows. We have as thousands of cows are described in the Srimad Bhagavatam that, they have about thousands of cows. And Krishna says like, we are like the servants of cows and the cows, they need grazing place. They need a pasture, like a green pasture. And around Mathura is like a urban place. It's like a city. And he says around Mathura, you will not be able to provide pasture to them. So how can we put the cows in trouble for our sake? So therefore he says, please go back. He makes a request to Nand Maharaj. Then Nand Maharaj says that actually Krishna, the cows will not be able to live without you. They love you so much. They are like, they won't be able to stay without you. So Krishna actually says, I actually have thought about it. And I know what to do. So he says, I'll give my dress and my garlands and my ornaments to Subala. He says, Subala, he looks just like me. And when the cows smell the fragrance of my body from my dress, which Subala would be wearing, they will think that, this is Krishna only. So there are many such, arguments that happen between Krishna and Nand Maharaj. It's not practical to go into all the arguments. But then finally what happens is, very tearfully, Nand Maharaj departs. And Nand Maharaj, when Nand Maharaj departs, along with the other Vrindavan Vasis, at that time, Krishna has no one with him. All those people he loved from his childhood, he has to see them go away. And at the same time, he also has to maintain his own composure so that Nanda Maharaj doesn't break down. So it's very difficult for him. Krishna also has a heart and his heart is also breaking at that time. So at that time, he has no one to turn to except Balaram. And Krishna and Balaram, what Jiva Goswami describes is, that they fall into each other's arm and they cry bitterly, cry in separation from Vrindavan, longing to be back there. No, but they were just not able to get back to Vrindavan. So there's a call of the heart and there's a call of duty. And these two are pulling them in two different directions. So then Balaram actually, he consoles Krishna. He says, Krishna, you have to do your duty. Then Krishna with his head on Balaram's shoulders, he cries and cries, till all the tears in his eyes dries up. And then he tearfully goes back to the house of Vasudeva and Devaki. And as he's staying there, his heart is constantly remembering Vrindavan. And the primary solace he gets is by talking with Balaram about Vrindavan, remembering Vrindavan. So we know that Jagannath story is also, it stems from here actually. So the primary pastime about Jagannath happens in Dwarka, it is the way it is described that the pastime is that Krishna is longing for Vrindavan. So, and at that time, we know that there's a storytelling that happens when Rohini gathers all the queens of Krishna and then he tells the story of Krishna and Balaram in Vrindavan. But anyway, so now Vasudev, what happens is he observes. that you know, every parent actually want their child to be happy. So he sees that Krishna is not happy here. And he actually thinks what to do. So for a child, the closest relationship is his mother. And Vasudeva observes that Krishna, he is not even able to address Devaki as his mother. So from a 10-year-old child's perspective, if you say you take that child from his home and bring him to a new home and then tell him that, this is your new mother. So mother is actually not just a name. There is a relationship and there is affection. So Vasudeva thinks that maybe I can take Krishna back to Vrindavan for some days and then Krishna will be a little happy. But then all the Yadus, they object to this idea. They say, no. So if you take Krishna there, he will never come back. They say that we don't want, we don't know what those Rajvasis have done to Krishna. They say that they have fed butter to Krishna and that have made Krishna mad for Vrindavan. So if we have to get Krishna back, then the only way is that we should cut off all the contact from Vrindavan. We should not let Krishna meet anyone from Vrindavan. We should basically, we should not trigger anything that will cause Krishna to remember Vrindavan. So that is the only way we can get Krishna back and he can be happy with us. Now, initially, when Nand Maharaj and Krishna separate, at that time, Nand Maharaj tells Krishna that I will keep sending messengers to, to know how you're doing, etc. But what the Yadus do is, their intention is that Krishna should be happy with us. So they feel that if the memories of the past keep coming, then Krishna won't be happy. So when the messengers from Vrindavan come, Yadus, they will use some various pretext and they will not let the messengers meet Krishna. Now, of course, we know that Krishna and Balaram keep sending some messages and gifts secretly, but overall, the connection becomes very, very less. So then when there is this secret conversation, secret messages that are being sent, like I will come. No, I will come regularly and then Yadus won't be able to stop me from meeting you. Excuse me. But Krishna actually sends a message. No, he says, no, you cannot come here. So Nand Maharaj again sends a message back. No, why I can't come there? Excuse me. So Krishna says at that time, no, I am staying here to protect the Yadus from their enemies. Now the enemies of the Yadus, they have kind of become my own enemies and they will become the enemies of all those who are connected with me. So if they think that Vrajavasis are very close to me, then in order to get back to me, in order to take revenge against me, they'll attack you. And if I am in Mathura, I cannot protect Vrindavan. So therefore we should make it appear to the world that actually there was no affection between me and you. There is no, so this is, I have stayed at your place for some time, but now that I have come here, I have forgotten you. So this is what Krishna actually kind of sends a message back to Nand Maharaj. So this is the predicament that the Vrajavasis had. Now we hear that they were so much in separation from Krishna and Vrindavan and Mathura, they are so near each other. It could have been just few hours to get to Mathura from Vrindavan. But this is the reason due to which they couldn't go to Mathura. They couldn't go because that would have endangered Vrindavan and Krishna didn't want that to happen. So Krishna was in one sense completely disconnected from the Vrajavasis at that time. So when this is happening and Balaram ji is noticing that Krishna is not happy about the, so Balaram ji thinks what to do. So he thinks that I have to somehow allay Krishna's suffering. So for Balaram ji also, if we look at it, he was also not much older from Krishna. He was also like a child, but still he was trying to take the role of an elder brother and solace his younger brother. So when Vasudev saw both these brothers so morose, that time he got an idea. He thought, I cannot get the woman who Krishna thinks to be his mother, but Krishna has been there in Vrindavan even with Rohini. And Rohini is Balaram's mother. So he thinks that I'll call Rohini back. And if I get Rohini back, then at least Krishna will have some maternal figure who he knows from childhood, from not just childhood, from infancy actually. And maybe Krishna will be happier then. So then he sends a message to Vrindavan. The message says, please send Rohini. It's a long message, but ultimately the idea is that he wants Rohini to come back. And when Rohini gets this message, he tells Yashoda, "No, how can I go without you, Yashoda? No, we are like one soul in two bodies. So I can't live without you. So I don't want to go." So then Yashoda says, "Yes, and actually this is why you should go. When you go to Mathura and you embrace Krishna, you put him on your lap, you feed him, and you know, it will be as if I am hugging Krishna. No, it is as if I am feeding him and I will be keeping him on my lap. So this way, at least I'll get some solace." So ultimately, you know, Yashoda pushes Rohini, Mother Rohini, to go back to Mathura. Now, when Rohini comes to Mathura, both Krishna and Balaram, we know the main storyline. Both of them treated both the mothers as their own mother. But still, for Krishna, Yashoda was his mother, and for Balaram, Rohini was his mother. So Krishna was delighted to see Rohini, but Balaram was even more delighted. Then Balaram told Rohini how much Krishna is suffering, in separation from Vrindavan. So he told to Rohini that actually Krishna is tormented day and night in thoughts of Vrindavan. Now he is here, he's doing his duties, but still he is in agony in separation from Vrindavan. So at that time, Rohini thinks that maybe I can do something. So now if we understand it a little better, the problem is that Krishna is not just torn between two families, but he is torn between two families who have become somewhat hostile to each other. So this hostility is not in a negative sense. It is basically in love of Krishna only. So both families want Krishna, and Rohini thinks if somehow I can decrease the hostility to a certain extent. So to give a more contemporary example, say there is a couple who have a child, and for some reason the couple separates and they have a custody battle for the possession of the child. And the poor child, he is actually torn in between the two parents. So if for the child's sake, if the couple maintains some congenial relationship, that is better actually for the child. So Rohini thought that I will act as a mediator and I will try to tell the Mathuravasis how much the Rajvasis, they love Krishna and how much Krishna loves. You know, it's from the both sides, not just that the Rajvasis want Krishna back. It's from both sides. So ultimately, their concern is also for Krishna only. The concern of the Yadus is only for Krishna only. So what she does is, she, in casual conversations, etc., she starts speaking about Vrajvasis. And you know, when she starts speaking about the love that Vrajvasis had for Krishna and Krishna, the way Krishna loved Vrajvasis, she notices that actually these Yadus, they are started to get irritated now. So one time they very directly tell to Rohinis, they say, "Oh Rohini, we thought you are in our party, but it seems you are in their party only." So then Rohini actually, she becomes disheartened and she realizes that she won't be able to do much. So actually she goes and she tells Balaram, and Balaram says that, "Yes, no, this is like a test for us. Somehow we have to, get through it." So actually, it's a long story, we don't have much time, but then Vasudev observes that bringing Rohini has helped a little bit, but still did not help a lot, because it just, to a certain extent, Krishna still is missing his friends, the gopis, so many things that he is missing about Vrindavan. So what happens when we look at it from a parent's perspective, when the child is upset, so what do the parents do? They try to provide some engagement for the child. Say if the child is very sad at one place, then what we could do is send the child to some other place. So Vasudev thinks that I can do two things at one go. Now he thinks that Krishna has always been in Vrindavan. So, and Vrindavan, as we know, is like a rural, it's like a remote rural area. So he says that maybe, and now Krishna has come to a city, and that is also kind of one reason. So maybe I can send Krishna to more like a rural place, and that will help Krishna a little bit. So he decides that let me send Krishna to a Gurukul. So, and then not just any Gurukul, he decides to send him to a Gurukul which is far away from Vrindavan. So what happens is Mathura and Vrindavan are so close. And the Yadus, they have their suspicion. Every morning when they would get up, they would wake up, they'll go to Krishna's room and check if Krishna is there today or not. They are always in suspicion that Krishna might run away at night, because they can see Krishna is longing for Vrindavan. And due to his longing for Vrindavan, they're always fearful. So they decide to send Krishna to a place which is far away from Vrindavan. So we know that they send Krishna to Sandipini Muni's ashram. So when Vasudev actually tells Krishna to go to ashram, he immediately agrees, but he says that I will not go on a chariot escorted by soldiers, because what will happen is it will raise suspicion of the enemy. That if the enemies comes to know that I and Balram and I, we are not here, they will try to take advantage of the situation and they try to attack. So therefore we will go secretly so that nobody knows about it. So therefore, he says, when we see that when Krishna actually, when he goes to Gurukul, he actually has a very accelerated learning course. It's like a crash course. Now he goes there and then he does like a super fast learning and he comes back again very quickly. He doesn't stay for a very long time in Gurukul, as unlike what if we see Lord Ram's Leela, he stays there for a very long time. So at the Gurukul, actually, Vasishtha Muni's ashram. That is in the Ram Leela. But here Krishna doesn't stay for that long, just few months maybe, or like more than a year maybe, a little bit. So now when Krishna actually had he had stayed at Mathura for some time, he had slowly started developing some acclimatization, and he slowly started developing affectionate relationships in Mathura. So but now what happens is he has to go away from Mathura also to a Gurukul. And again, the only person with him is Balram. So actually, throughout Krishna's pastimes, wherever he goes, one person with him always is, which is Balram, is always there with him. So now when Krishna and Balram are at Sandipini Muni's ashram, at Avantipur. Avantipur is now known as Ujjain. That's very close to where I was born. So I've been there multiple times. It's a very nice place. So when they are at Avantipur at that time, they stay there Sandipini Muni, he welcomes them. Krishna and Balram don't proclaim that, we are Yadus. Just by seeing them, Sandipini Muni could understand that they are very special people. So what happens is when Krishna is actually manifest in this world, he doesn't always manifest, his godhood. He doesn't go and proclaim that, I am God. So what actually in turn he does is he conceals his godhood. So why he does that? He wants to reciprocate love with his devotees. So because of that, if he just keeps proclaiming that, I am God, he doesn't want that. He tries to conceal his his godhood, and he reciprocates love with his devotees in that mood. So when Krishna and Balram, they start staying in the Gurukul, so in daytime they would be busy in various activities, but at night again Krishna, he would very fervently remember Vrindavan. And when Krishna remembers Vrindavan, again it is Balram who offers him solace. So they would hug each other, they cry, and they remember Vrindavan. Krishna is like a small little boy. And since the time he left Vrindavan, everything for him is constantly changing. But the only thing that is constant with him is the association of Lord Balram. So in Ram Leela also, we see that Lakshman is constantly there with Ram. But most of the times, it is Lakshman who is emotional. And Ram has to calm him down. So Lakshman would get angry and Ram has to, pacify him. So Ram is like the elder brother in Ram Leela, but in Krishna Leela, Krishna is younger and, he becomes very disconsolate, and it is Balram who actually consoles him. So when Krishna and Balram come back from the Gurukul, they have to do their thread ceremony. Now when Krishna is staying in Mathura, Nanda Maharaj is still thinking that Krishna is my son. So now what happens is, if Krishna is performing his thread ceremony in presence of his Kshatriya father, it is, Jiva Goswami explains that it is as if he is kind of accepting that I am a Kshatriya and I am a son of a Kshatriya. So, and in turn, if he is doing it in the presence of a Vaishya father, he is kind of accepting that I am a Vaishya. So now, when they're ready to perform this thread ceremony, Krishna thinks, what should I do? This is like a predicament. I don't want the Rijavasis, they will definitely come to know that there was a thread ceremony held and Krishna has, he has accepted the thread. So what he does is, he sends a messenger to Vrindavan, like a secret messenger. And then the messenger gives a message to Nanda Maharaj that, you know, the message is something like, you know, my heart is in Vrindavan, so, but I have to do this as a duty. You know, I have to accept this thread ceremony here. But what you can do is you can also have like a parallel thread ceremony going on right at the same time when it is happening in Mathura. And, you know, I will be present there in your heart. So he basically tries to balance both the sides. So as this goes on more and more, at one time, Balram gets really angry with Krishna. He says, Krishna, you told the Vrajavasis that you will come back soon. And, you know, such a long time has passed and you have still not gone back to Vrindavan. So Krishna says, no, how can I go back? I am not getting permission from Vasudev. He says, my Nanda Maharaj has bound me in two ways. He has bound me with his own love and he has bound me with his words also. But he said that you should always obey Vasudev. So now Vasudev will never permit me to go to Vrindavan. So how can I go there? So actually I'm fast forwarding a little bit. So actually Balram says that, no, okay, if you can't go, then I will go over there. And then he actually, Krishna says, yes, this is very good. You should go over there. So this is, so Balram actually goes to Balram actually gets permission very easily. And in fact, both Devaki and Vasudev and Rohini, they are all very happy about this decision that Balram wants to go to Vrindavan for a few days. But this happens right a little time after Krishna had already sent Uddhav to Vrindavan. So now when Balramji goes to Vrindavan, you know, he actually is just not visiting himself. He's also representing Krishna in Vrindavan. So he also brings message from Krishna for the Vrajvasis. And the message again is same thing. I will come back very soon. The same message that Uddhav had given to Vrindavan Vasis. And, you know, the Vrindavan Vasis are kind of tired of hearing this, that I'll come back soon. And all the messengers, the secret messengers also that Krishna had been sending, they have been giving the same message also to Vrindavan Vasis. So when Lord Balram, he reaches Vrindavan, the Vrajvasis are delighted to see him. And Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Mai, they kind of release motion of tears. Practically, they cry so much and seeing Balram. They actually embrace Lord Balram. They bless him profusely. And actually, what happens is Lord Balram also has different leelas with the Vrindavan Vasis. So it is explained by Jiva Goswami that there are two types of bhakti. There is Vyoga and there is Sanyoga. So Vyoga is like bhakti in separation, love in separation. And Sanyoga is like devotion in union. So it is said that love in separation, Vyoga, and it is said to be higher than love in union. So the gopis, they have been experiencing love in separation for so long. And when they see Balram, actually what happens is there are two sets of gopis, you know. So one set of gopis are like Lord Balram's associates, and there is another set of gopis who have been Krishna's associates. So the associates of Lord Balram, these gopis, they have so like many pastimes with Lord Balram, and the other group of gopis who are Krishna's gopis, they actually see that, and you know that actually kind of reminds these other gopis of Krishna. So their remembrance of Krishna, that gets stimulated further. And although like they're separated, they also feel some level of union with Krishna. So Balaram actually goes on behalf of Krishna and he serves the devotees in both ways. Now, he is serving as if he is himself present and as if he is giving the association of Krishna also to the Vrindavan Vasis. So actually what happens is Balaramji plays one role that we discussed, that he plays the role of reminding Krishna of the Vrajvasis, you know, when Krishna is not in Vrindavan. And then he also plays the role of, you know, reminding Vrajvasis of Krishna when Krishna is gone out. So he does both. And actually, if we see, this is also the role of the spiritual master also. The spiritual master reminds us of Krishna and the spiritual master reminds Krishna of us. So you know, what do we mean that you know, he reminds Krishna of us? Now, Krishna doesn't need to be reminded of us. He's always there with us in our hearts and Krishna is very close to us. But when we say spiritual minds, master reminds Krishna of us, he likes petitions Krishna on our behalf. And then he requests Krishna that, you know, please accept this person, you know, this my disciple, accept this. So exactly that is the kind of role that Balaramji is also playing over there. He reminds Krishna of the Vrajvasis and he is reminding Vrajvasis of Balaram, of Krishna also. So if you see the pastimes of Lord Balaram, you know, his actions are like inconceivable. You know, sometimes he gets angry, sometimes he is very lovable. So, but all of his actions in different moods are meant to enhance his service to Krishna. It is basically to serve Krishna. And one of the way Lord Balaram serves Krishna, this is the last point I'll make here. One of the ways that Lord Balaram serves Krishna is in Viparit Rasa. Now, Viparit Rasa is not one of the 12 prominent rasas that is mentioned in the scriptures. It is like more like an emotional flavor to the existing rasa. So what this rasa is, God, when he wants to do something, nobody can stop him from doing it. We know that God is omnipotent. Nobody can stop God when he decides something. So how Balaram, what he does is, he becomes the guru of Duryodhan. So Balaram plays the role of obstructing Krishna. So when he becomes the guru, we know that Lord Balaram actually teaches Duryodhan the mace fight, and Duryodhan becomes like very competent in this mace fight. So Lord Balaram becomes the guru of Duryodhana not because, you know, Duryodhana had some special qualification, but mostly because he wanted to actually serve Krishna in that way. So he trains the opponent of Krishna's devotee so that there can be a bigger and like a more exciting fight. When this fight between Bhima and Duryodhana happens, it's like very, very nail-biting fight. So overall, the role of Balaramji is to keep the devotion alive in separation. So we are like kind of separated from Krishna now. And, you know, his role is to, you know, kindle our devotion and, you know, enhance it so that we can experience Krishna through various ways. And that is one reason he is known as the Adi Guru. So just stop here, and this last point I'll make that, you know, once Prabhupada was asked that what is the best prayer? So Prabhupada actually told that we should pray to Krishna to give us the strength to serve him. So actually, similarly, what we can do, the way we can pray to Lord Balaram is, we can request him that we know that our lives are so happening. You know, there are so many turmoils that are happening in our life. We all live in the material world, and material world by nature is, you know, very disruptive. So, but we can pray to Lord Balaram that actually, you know, no matter what happens in my life, please give me the strength to always serve Krishna. So that is like the best prayer. Prabhupada also described that we should pray in this way to Krishna. And on the occasion of Balaram Jayanti, we can pray to Lord Balaram like that. So I'll stop here. I'm sorry I exceeded the time. So, and I want to see if there is any, you know, comments or, you know, anything, anyone would like to share anything.
Prabhuji, I have 2 points here to make.
Okay.
Yeah, one thing, as you said, Nand Maharaj did not know Krishna is not his son. But what I read before, when Vasudev brought Krishna from prison to Nand Maharaj, Nand Maharaj was the one who exchanged the baby, and he kept Krishna next to Yashoda Mata and give a yoga maya to Vasudevji, and that's what he took back to prison.
So actually, I understood your point. So yeah. What the way it is explained is that, you know, Krishna, in order to reciprocate love, you know, what he does is through the agency of yoga maya, he covers the knowledge of the different people. In that way, we know that, you know, just before Krishna was born, Vishnu himself had come and given darshan to Vasudev and Devaki, that, you know, and then he said that I am coming as your son, and he tells the full story. But still we see that when Krishna is doing different things, they are very worried for Krishna. And if Krishna is God, then why would they get worried about Krishna? So actually what Krishna does is, through the agency of the Maya, he covers the knowledge. So actually we have Mahamaya and Yoga Maya. Mahamaya, both the Yoga Maya and Mahamaya, their role is to illusion people. So, but the difference is Mahamaya illusions people and take them away from Krishna, and Yogamaya, it illusions people and brings people closer to Krishna. So whatever is necessary to bring the person closer to Krishna, that is the role of Yogamaya. And that Yogamaya actually exists in the spiritual world. So in that way, in the spiritual world also, you know, the devotees which are there already in the highest Golok Vrindavan, they don't love Krishna knowing that he is a supreme lord. They just naturally love Krishna. So Krishna, what he does is through the agency of the yoga maya, he covers their, you know, knowledge, that the knowledge of Krishna's godhood, and then that makes the you know, the reciprocation more sweeter.
Yeah, that's true. But what I'm saying here, like as you said, Nand Maharaj does not know that Krishna is not my son, and he was happy that everyone was proclaiming that my son is their son. So, but it is something he knows already. Yashoda was the one who does not know that Krishna is not my son.
So yeah, that's why I'm trying to explain that, you know, that understanding is like that remembrance is kind of covered by yoga maya. So he always thinks that Krishna is my son only.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, he makes him forgetful of that.
And as you said, Lakshman was the who aggressive, and in
sorry,
the next
Prabhu, you are breaking up.
Yuga, like Krishna has become a little aggressive. But can you hear me now?
Yeah, you are breaking up a little bit. Can everyone else able to hear Aniket Prabhu?
No.
Okay. So, try again, Prabhu. You are breaking up a little bit.
It's getting worse.
Yeah.
It's a doctor.
Okay, I think Aniket Prabhu is having a bad connection. In the meantime, if anyone else would like to add something, Peri Prabhu,
yeah,
add something.
The Krishna Katha and Balram Katha are so beautiful. We didn't mind that you went way beyond your time.
Yeah, but still, I had to leave some time. So I had to skip a lot of things. Somehow, I always do that. I plan for some time and I always exceed it. So today, I had to skip a lot of things that I wanted to say. But that's fine. Maybe some other day, we can cover that.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Have a nice night.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhu,
okay,
would you like to add something
now?
No, Prabhu, it's still very bad. I mean,
it's better now?
A little better now. Yes.
Is it better now?
Yes. Hare Krishna. I think we lost him.
Where is this story from?
This is from Gopal
Champu.
Gopal
Champu?
Yes, Mataji. This is, you know, Gopal Champu is written by Jeeva Goswami. So.
Yes. I haven't read it though.
Okay. Anything that you would like to add or, you know, you think it was not correct, Mataji?
You should give a similar lecture on Janmashtami. We would like to hear also.
Prabhuji, can you hear me now?
Yes, Prabhu, I can hear you now. Yes, Prabhu,
okay.
Please go ahead.
No, so the another thing, like as you said, Lakshman was the aggressive, and Rama used to pacify him. And in the next yuga, Krishna was aggressive. But what I read, again, it's Balrama who was aggressive all the time, and Krishna used to pacify him.
I didn't say he was aggressive. I said he was more emotional. So here what happens is the role that Lord Ram and Lakshman were playing in the Ram Leela, that gets kind of reversed in one way. So Krishna kind of becomes more impetuous here in this Leela, but it's not that he is aggressive and Lord Balram is not aggressive. That's not what I mean. So Lord Balram kind of plays the role of an elder brother, and he tries to maintain his composure, and he definitely gets angry at that time. We see that he kills Romharshana. He basically chastises Yamuna. But overall, if we see, you know, he kind of try to serve Krishna in different ways and try to, you know, help Krishna come out of this emotional turmoil that he's having when he's away from Vrindavan.
Okay.
So see what happens is Lord Balaram, everybody knew that he is the son of Rohini, and Rohini is the wife of Vasudev. So everybody knew that he is a Yadu, and Lord Balaram also knew from beginning that he is a Yadu. He is not a, you know, so But the question is about Krishna, that Krishna is, you know, Krishna was more in, you know, tilting towards Vrindavan, but at the same time he had to be in Mathura also. So for Lord Balaram, his identity is very, very clear to everyone. There is no push and pull happening for Lord Balaram. The push and pull that is happening is more for Krishna in this.
You don't think of it as a custody battle in modern times, right? Like, it sounds so much like a custody battle of modern times when you put it that way.
Right.
I mean, of course, in more civilized manner.
Right. Okay. Any other comments or anything?
It seems like Krishna, if he's feeling this way about Vrindavan, he can go to Vrindavan. It's not like his argument was, because then his enemies are going to attack them. He can protect them from anywhere, and he can do anything.
But Prabhu, we see that when Krishna is attending the Rajasuya Yagya of Yudhishthira, at that time this demon Shalva comes and he like makes an air attack on Dwarka. And then he kinds of destroys Dwarka to a large extent. And, you know, at that time when Krishna gets the news that, you know, Dwarka is under attack, and both Krishna and Balaram were away, so they both rush back to Dwarka, and then they kind of dismantle the attack. So the point is, I mean, you are right that he is omnipotent. He can do anything he can do. But from a Leela perspective, you have to understand that, you know, that he can only be at one place at one time. So he is not revealing his omnipotence over there. His purpose is something else. And actually, one of the interesting thing that I read in Gopal Champu is Jiva Goswami explains that we generally know that, you know, Krishna took the Mathuravasis to Dwarka because there were so many attacks that were happening in Mathura, and that was kind of destroying the peace of Mathura. But Jiva Goswami describes that is just an external reason. You know, it is Krishna and Balaram both enjoyed killing all these demons, and they were very competent to, you know, no matter how many times the city is being attacked, they can single-handedly destroy.
Just froze. We don't hear anything, or you're not moving.
Our sister Dwarka is. Now, when these armies come, I'm sorry.
Well, for a few minutes, 30 seconds or so, you were frozen and we couldn't hear anything.
Oh, okay. So what did you hear last, Prabhuji? Hare Krishna?
That it's the Leela that he's not being at this two ply, but you said when Dwarka was his.
Yeah, okay. You are able to hear me now, right?
Yes.
Okay, so what I was saying is,
the point I'm getting at is there is another reason besides that, because it's not that good of a reason. You know, he could do it. And you say he can't be in two places at one time, but he did it in Dwarka. He's in 16,108 palaces all at the same time. He does it.
Yeah, I agree, Prabhu. But I know that if all the queens think that Krishna is only with me. Only Narad Muni could see that, you know, Krishna is there. But anyway, I understand your point. So please reveal the other thing that you wanted to say. What's the other reason?
I don't know. I'm asking you, maybe. And you were kind of getting at it, I thought.
So mostly to basically let the Vrindavan Vasis get purified in separation from Krishna. They will constantly think about Krishna and they will get purified. That is one. But I was talking something different about why Krishna takes everyone away to Dwarka. That was like a different reason given by Jiva Goswami in Gopal Champu.
What was that reason?
So Jiva Goswami describes that the external reason is that, you know, there were so many attacks were happening on Mathura, and that was kind of destroying the peace of Mathura. So Krishna and Balaram, they thought that, you know, if we take these people away to a place which is like guarded, nobody will be able to attack, and that will maintain the peace of the city. But Jiva Goswami describes that is just an external reason. So he writes that when these armies would attack, especially when Jarasandha would come with his own army, So they have to pass through that area of Vrindavan. And what these soldiers do is, basically when they would come, this big, big armies, they, it used to come, they would basically plunder the villages, on their way to basically get food, etc. So every time this army of Jarasandh is coming, so this Vrindavan Vasis, they had to leave their homes and they have to hide in the forest, deep in the forest. And that was kind of disrupting their lives. So the internal reason for Krishna taking everyone away from Mathura to Dwarka was so that, you know, this Jarasandh, he should not attack again and come through that path of Vrindavan, and then Vrindavan Vasis have to run away in fear. So that is what he wanted to avoid. That is what Jiva Goswami describes in Gopal Swami.
But you just said that he wouldn't take them from Mathura to Dwarka because they needed the pastures for their cows.
No, not the Vrindavan Vasis. The people who live in Mathura. So we know that from Mathura, he takes everyone away to Dwarka, right? So I'm talking about the reason, that reason why he takes everyone away from Mathura to Dwarka. Vrindavan Vasis stay in Vrindavan. They don't go to Dwarka. They stay in Vrindavan. But what happens is when this Jarasandh will attack, you know, at that time, Vrindavan Vasis will have to run away in fear and they would hide in jungle, in the forest. So that was kind of disrupting their lives a lot. So to avoid that, Krishna actually, you know, he takes everyone away to Dwarka. That's what Jiva Goswami describes. That's the internal reason he says of Krishna taking everyone away from Mathura to Dwarka.
In the Gopal Champu, does he, Jiva Goswami, talk about how Krishna never leaves Vrindavan?
Yeah, that is also there, Mataji. That's true. So he describes that there is one Vrindavan Krishna, and then that Vrindavan Krishna always stay in Vrindavan. So he describes that when actually Nanda Maharaj brings Krishna from, when he brings the child Krishna from Mathura to Vrindavan, at that time, this Vrindavan Krishna and this the other Krishna, the Krishna that Vasudevya, they both combine and they are in the same position. But when Krishna kind of leaves Vrindavan, the Vrindavan Krishna stays in Vrindavan and the other Krishna leaves. So,
right.
But then why do they feel separation if the Vrindavan Krishna is still in Vrindavan?
He is not kind of manifest right there. But
manifest.
He's in their hearts.
Hearts, yes. Mm-hmm. He's not externally manifested that they can reciprocate with him. So.
And they're thinking of him, and whenever they're thinking of him, and they're always thinking of him, he's there.
But even when he is there with them, sometimes they feel separation. There's another kind of separation where they're afraid he's going to leave.
That's a very nice leader.
It's complicated, Mataji.
Esoteric, very esoteric.
Yeah.
Deep.
Nice, very nice. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Prabhu, I must say, it was a, of course, it was a nectar hearing from you. But another thing I must say that it was a very nice selection of story. First time you selected, at least it is appropriate for, like, you know, fallen people like me. Because last two Balaram Jayanti, I mean, I'm not saying anything against anyone. I'm just saying I heard past time like, say the Balarama had with his consorts, or Jamuna Devi. He was pulling Jamuna Devi again. Lord's pastime is Lord's pastime. We must appreciate it, whatever it is. But I'm just saying it's not appropriate for people like me. It was more appropriate for advanced devotees. But your selection was perfect. I wish everybody, like, you know, make selection like you, so that it's appropriate, like, general people. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Guruji.
I think Lakshman didn't sleep for 14 years. Maybe he wanted to sleep, so he wanted to become Balaram.
Yeah, that's a nice
that. I couldn't hear him.
We couldn't hear.
What did he say?
Kari Prabhu, this is Satyendra here. So Lakshmana, he didn't sleep for 14 years in Vanvas.
Wow.
No, what do you say after that?
So that's why he wanted to become the elder brother, so he can sleep and Krishna can take care of him.
Oh, that's a good reason.
For me, at least, I think sleep.
Yeah. All right, I think we can end here. So again, it was nice having this discussion, everyone. Thank you. Srila Balram ji ki jai.
Jai.
Thank you. Balram Jayanti ki.
Jai.
Thanks.
41, 42, 41, 42, 41, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42, 42,